by email or by talking to me come up and say pretty much the same thing over the last couple of days. Since Friday, I've had folks come to me and say, I'm praying for you, or I don't know how you're going to do this because somehow you have to make sense of this. Or the most profound question that I've gotten over the past few days is, all right, Pastor, you preached on forgiveness last week. What are you going to do with forgiveness now? Friday changed everything in our thinking. Friday largely framed, for many of us, even what our Christmas season will be like. Friday reframed our mood. It reframed our attitude. Friday seemed to change everything. But the truth is that in many churches and for many Christians, they would take last week's sermon on forgiveness and turn and run from it at this point. Or at the very least, they would not address it. If we're to be honest with ourselves, most Christians don't know how to process last Sunday's sermon in light of last Friday's events. And the truth is, I'm not going to offer a whole lot of great answers today. Because many people come to me and they say, well, Pastor Mike, how am I supposed to understand this? How can you make sense of this? Or better yet, Pastor Mike, what am I supposed to tell my children? How am I supposed to explain this to them? Well, I have to be honest with you about the second question. The way you tell a child about a horrific situation or a truly frightening reality is very dependent on the personality and the nature of the individual child. I can't tell you today how to tell your children. I can tell you today that you need to somehow address this with them. You need to not ignore it. Because they're processing it, they're dealing with it, and even if you don't talk about it at home, they will hear about it at school. You need to frame that discussion, not someone else. You say, well, Pastor, if you're not going to tell me how to do that, what am I supposed to do? Here's what I'm going to do for you today. I'm going to help you process this reality personally. Because if I can help you process it, then you, being the person who knows your child better than anyone else, or your grandchild better than anyone else, can help them process it. And we're going to work through it today. We're going to work through it reasonably, and we're going to work through it honestly. The place we have to start is really quite simple. How in the world could this happen? Let me give you a philosophical answer to that, and I won't spend much time on it because it's not what you want. We cannot make sense of moments like last Friday. And let me tell you why. We were not created for them. God created humankind and put us in a garden that was perfect, where there was no sin and there was no sorrow and there was no sickness and there was no death and there was no evil. But by our own choosing, and listen, be careful, do not try to blame all of this on Adam and Eve. We would have made the same choices. We have made the same type choices. God has told each and every one of us, stay away from that. And what did we do? Because of those choices, evil entered the world. And evil does the inexplicable. Evil does things that make no sense and that destroy lives and that destroy innocence. The reality is that things like this happen because sin and evil exist in our world. And the first reality we're going to have to process today is this one. Evil people do exist in the world around us, and they do indescribably terrible things. And let's be clear. That young man in Connecticut is not the only one that did something indescribably horrible this past week. Yes, evil people are rare. And yes, most of us will never be directly impacted by one of them. But they do exist, and we must realize that evil exists and that from time to time it takes over an individual so that we can prepare ourselves. So that we can protect ourselves. We must recognize the existence of this, and we must help our children recognize the existence of this. So, Pastor Mike, you're not helping me a whole lot. I know. But can I give you the counterpart to what I just taught you? Evil does exist, and so does God. We have a God in heaven who exists and who has already defeated the evil in the world around us. Evil exists and it is dangerous and it is damaging to us, but it is a defeated enemy. It is not a gone enemy. It is defeated for the eternal, but in the temporary, in the now, we must be prepared for it. But we set our minds for the fact that in the eternal, God has already defeated the evil that so bedevils us right now. God is real and God is present. He is here. I cannot explain this to you. I can only tell you that it's true. I cannot explain everything I know to be true. Everybody understand that? There are a lot of things I know to be true that I cannot explain. Let me give you one of them. Have no doubt. Somehow, in ways that we will not understand until we ourselves find ourselves in heaven, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit was in that schoolhouse on Friday. And somehow, in ways that we do not understand, God brought hope and peace and comfort and strength in those indescribably horrible moments. You say, Pastor Mike, that doesn't make sense. I understand that. I got that. I'm not trying to come against that. I hear what you're saying. But you must put together two things that are real. Evil does exist, and God also exists. And evil is not God's equal. But we can't let it win. Evil will not win in an eternal sense. We've already talked about that. But we cannot allow evil to win even in a temporary sense. There are only two ways that we allow evil to win in our lives. One would be that we choose to live in fear. Friends, listen to me. We cannot live our lives in fear. If we do, then the evil that took over that young man wins the day. God did not give us a spirit of fear, the Bible tells us. Because God stands by us, and no matter what the world might bring, no matter what the world might try to do to us or in us, God is always greater. He is always sufficient. He is always more. And we trust him. But there's a second way we can allow evil to win. And that is if we choose to exist in anger. We can not allow anger or fear to overtake our lives. Do you realize that if we allow anger to take over our lives, we give that young man control over the decisions we make for the next few years of our existence? Why in the world would we do that? And generally speaking, anger takes over because fear is already in place. And when you have fear that you feel you could do nothing about it, usually turns into anger. And now all of a sudden, the one who wronged us owns us. That's not what God created us for. You say, well, Pastor, how do I get past that? Oh, see, I'm not going to run away from this. I'm going to run straight at it. And some of you are going to freak out. Forgiveness. I'm not going to run away from last week's sermon. I can't. It's the Bible. Look at it. Here's the last point from last week's sermon. Let me be honest with you. Hold on. Some of you are angry right this minute that I even put that up there. You're thinking to yourself, how could you even begin to suggest such a thing? Pastor, don't you know what that says? Yes, I wrote it. The first line. God wrote the second line. I know what it says. I know what it says. But we must either let it go or it will own us. Folks, this word forgive in Matthew, in the Greek, if you look it up, has a multitude of meanings. There's a long list of phrases, if you look it up in the Greek, that this word could work for. Can I give you just three of those? Let me give you just three short phrases that come out of this Greek word for forgive in this verse in Matthew. This is the word that Jesus used. This is the concept that Jesus used when he said this. I'm going to give you three of these. Take a look at them. They're very simple. To let go. You got to let it go. I know. We want to get even. Look, I know. There are spiritual people in this world that are so spiritual that they immediately went to the right place and anger and all of this didn't take hold. And they did. I know there are some folks like that. But I'm not that guy. I'm like most of you. I just want a little peace. You know what I'm saying? Come on. But I got to let it go. There is no one to punish. And make no mistake about it. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. The man that has done this is facing the penalty of this as we speak. I got to let it go. You got to let it go. Because if you hold on to it, it'll eat you up. You got to set it aside. You got to release it. Now listen to me. I need you to hear me. You got to hear what I'm about to say. This is important. I forgive is not the same as. It doesn't matter. Everybody got that? I forgive is not the same as it's okay. It is not okay. But I forgive is not equivalent to it's okay. I forgive is not equivalent to it doesn't matter. I forgive is not equivalent to we go on vacation together. I forgive is I set it aside. I let it go. I release it. It's not mine anyway. It's God's. You say, why are you doing this? Why are you preaching last week's sermon? Because I can't get to this week's sermon until I have you wrap up last week's sermon. Because last week we preached on forgiveness just like I've been doing for the last few minutes. But this week we're going to talk about peace. And you can't get to peace without forgiveness. You have to hear that. Your Christmas is ruined if you can't come to a point of set aside or release or let this go. But it's not just about Christmas. It's about finding peace in Christ. You say, well, how do I do that, Pastor? There's a story that we're going to take out of the book of Luke, chapter 10. And I'm not gonna spend a lot of time here. I know the time, and I know I've spent a lot of time so far, but I want to give you these three simple little things, okay? I want to give you three simple little things to carry forward. And I need you to understand, you're going to have to apply last week's sermon in order to make this week's sermon work for you. Everybody's got that? Even in light of Friday, we can't run away from that because God's word is true even when it's difficult to apply. Everybody's got it? But there's this short little story account in Jesus' life where he goes to Mary and Martha's house. And, you know, what would you do if the Lord showed up at your house? I mean, how long, if you knew Jesus was coming to your house, how long would you spend cleaning up? What would you cook? What would you put out on the table? How would you decorate? Well, Martha's the one that's all into that thought. And Martha's working like a mad woman. She's doing everything. Jesus comes and he reclines at the table and he begins to talk. Mary walks out and she sits down at the feet of Jesus and she begins to listen to the conversation. And she's just taking it all in. And Martha is working her fingers to the bone. She is not doing this from a joyful spirit. We learn that in the Bible. We learn that she's actually becoming more and more angry as the minutes pass. Until finally she walks out into the crowd and she looks at Jesus and says, Lord, come on. Don't you see she ain't doing nothing? I am working myself to death and she's not doing anything. Lord, tell her to help me out. Sounds like my boys. When they were younger and I would give one of them a job and the other one wasn't doing anything, they would always point out to me what the other one was not doing. And that's what Martha's doing. And Jesus basically says to Martha, well, honey, you're the one that chose wrong, not her. Let's unpack that. Let's unpack that. Because honestly, we can get so caught up in unforgiveness or in busyness or in so many different things that we miss what God has for us. What God has for us is peace. But you can miss that in so many ways. Three things, three simple questions. Question number one, what really matters? What really matters? Mary's running around the place trying to get all of this stuff done. She's trying to make sure everything's perfect. She's trying to make sure everything is just right. What really matters in this moment is an important question. In fact, can I say to you, less than 2 weeks out, can I say this to you? What really matters about this season? In fact, let me stretch this out a little more. What really matters in your life? What matters? See, we get all caught up in things that don't really matter. We get all caught up in things that we think are highly important, but they're really not. I mean, they're okay. There's nothing wrong with them. It's just that we get caught up in the urgent and we miss the important. Don't be distracted by the temporary. If you're going to answer this question, what really matters, let me give you some advice. Don't be distracted by the temporary. Whether that temporary be decorations or whether it be anger or whether it be hurt, whatever it may be, these feelings will pass. These decorations will pass. All of these things will pass. Don't be distracted by the temporary. I was in North Carolina with my mom as we're putting things together with her. And so we're down there and all of a sudden she realizes she has a circle meeting. Now, a circle is a small group for churches that have a Sunday school and don't want to admit that they are holding small groups. So they don't call them small groups, they call them circles. And so Mama had a circle meeting, and it was at the pizza place. She said, Michael, you want to go with me to the circle meeting? I said, okay, I'll go with you to the circle meeting. Now, what that meant was I was going to have lunch with a whole bunch of ladies my mama's age who have known me, many of them, since I was real little. So I'm sitting down with them, you know, and I'm like the A, the token man, and two, the token kid at the table. I am 46 years old, and I'm at the kids' table again. You know what I'm saying? And in the midst of their conversation, one of the ladies said, well, you know what? You know what? I heard somebody say one time that you ought to bring out your finest china for the people that believe that you love the most. She said, and I just believe he's right. Said, you know, you bring out your fine china for people you don't even hardly know. And then all of a sudden your children come over for holidays and you don't break out the fine china. You ought to have fine china. But she said, you know what? I break out the fine china for my children every year because I believe that. And you know what my children tell me? She said, they tell me that they wish I'd just use paper plates. She said, I can't believe they feel that way. I bring it out the best for them. And at great risk to my own personal safety, I said, Miss Nancy, your kids want you to use paper plates because they don't want to wash your china. She said, well, I cooked. I said, I know that. And they know that. They know that. They realize that they ought to wash the china because you cook. They get that. But they don't want to wash your china. And she said, well, why not? And I said, well, there's two main reasons. One is there's nothing more nerve-wracking than handling your mama's fine china inside of slippery, soapy water. Because if you break anything, she will never forget. You'll have to put it on her tombstone. My child broke the china. You know, I mean, you can't, that's just nerve-wracking. I said, secondly, and I said, listen, I said, they'd like to spend time with you, not your kitchen sink. And she looked at me and went, Which means her children are going to wash china this year. Y'all listen. You got to ask the question, what really matters? Second question, what really counts? What really counts? Y'all listen, I need you to understand this. We all keep score. Y'all realize that, right? Every one of us keeps score. You know what the problem is? You know why it doesn't seem like we all keep score? Because we all keep a different score. But we all keep score. Martha has kept score here. I tend to believe that this is not the first time that Mary has wandered off and not helped Martha. I tend to believe that Mary has good intentions, but she's kind of one of those people that somewhere in the midst of doing all the work in the kitchen, something happens and she goes, pretty butterfly, and she's off out the door. And Martha has kept score. She has kept score of all the times that Mary has walked away from her. She has kept score of all the things that don't seem right. She kept track of them. And now, in this moment, when the most important person that she knows of on the planet, the most important person on the planet, walks into her house, now, of all times, come on, Mary, really, now? You can't stay focused at least today. I'll give you tomorrow. And she's had all she could take. And she goes to Jesus with her scorecard. says, this isn't fair. Y'all, you got to stop counting what doesn't count. You got to stop counting what doesn't matter. Don't be distressed by the personal. I need you to hear me. I need you to hear me very carefully. This is not about you. If you insist that Christmas is all about you, I can promise you this, you will have a horrible Christmas. It'll be awful. It'll be awful because it won't live up to your expectations. It won't be what you expected. If you believe, if you insist that all of the events you go to over the next week or two are all about you, you are not going to enjoy any of them. I'm going to say something difficult. If you believe that the things in this world that have hurt you are all about you and your hurt, you will never find peace. That's got to be let go. That's got to be set aside. That's got to be released. Peace will come when I stop counting what doesn't matter. Pastor, are you telling me my hurt doesn't matter? No, listen to me. I'm telling you there are things that are more important and worthy of being counted. We got to count, listen carefully, what counts. We got to keep score only of what actually matters. Say, okay, fine. How do I determine that? Well, that would be the last question. I got to ask myself what matters, what really matters. I got to ask myself what really counts. And then I need to ask myself what really lasts. What really lasts? See, you're not going to know what matters and what counts until you get to this last one. You got to go through all these questions. What are the things that really matter? I mean, can I give you a very functional idea? Start with a list. Make a list. What really matters? And then ask yourself what really counts. Are the things on my matters list the things that actually count? Are the things on the list I'm counting the things that really matter? Mesh the two lists and then push them against the last grid, which is what really lasts. When you come up with a list of things that will really last, you need to be devoted to the eternal. You need to be devoted to the eternal. Now, I want to use an analogy here, and I want you to realize I'm not talking about you. Everybody got this? I'm talking about somebody else. If I've been to your event, I'm not talking about your event. Everybody got that? All right. I've been to a lot of weddings in my life. And I'm continually struck by one common thread within a wedding. We are so distracted by the things on the periphery of the wedding that we tend to miss the most important thing that takes place during the wedding. We're so distracted by the decorations. We're so distracted by getting all the right pictures. We're so distracted by getting just the right video. We're so distracted by all of that that we miss what really matters. We miss what will really last. I was in one wedding one time when I was younger, and I was handed a 5-page instruction manual on how to be an usher. I was stunned. 5 pages on what to do. I leaned to the guy beside me. I said, if your underwear goes up your crack. take the third finger of your left hand. You know what I'm saying? It was that crazy. Some of y'all are going, she didn't actually write that. No, she didn't. I made that up. But it was almost that detailed. You know what I'm saying? I was like, man, this is messed up. They're just getting hitched. When Tina and I got married in 1988, we went up and it was, it was not the greatest day of our lives. Some of you are going, oh! Listen to me. I have had a wonderful marriage. That was not a great day. My mama was losing her mind. And Tina's mama took an extra nerve pill, so she was floating. I wish I was making this up. You know that whole thing about don't see the bride on the day of the wedding? Yeah, we didn't do that. I called Tina up. I said, my mama's losing her mind. Tina said, well, my mama took an extra pill. I'm not exactly sure where she's at right now. I said, meet me at the mall. She said, okay. And we met at the mall and had lunch at the Chick-fil-A. All right. And let me tell you something I'm not entirely proud of. Tina and I have been in it. We were music majors. We performed a lot our whole lives. We finally had to come to the place that we said, you know what? Let's just perform what we need to on this stage and then move on. There's a picture of us as we're leaving the sanctuary. And that picture shows my face, and she's not exactly smiling, and I have a look on my face like I could just, you know, pound somebody in the ground at the moment. If you look closely, you'll figure out why. She's stepping on the front of her dress, and I'm afraid she's going to fall out on the floor, which makes me mad at the person that hemmed her dress. Why didn't they think of that? You know, and I'm just going, I can't believe these people on this money, on this dress, and here we are. And I just, I'm ready to leave. Which we did. And that part was good. Go ahead, let it sink in. We might have to record 11 o'clock. Yeah. Not a great day. Why? Because we, along with everybody else, were too focused on what didn't really matter. Because we, along with everybody else, were too busy counting what didn't really count. And because, you know what? That day came and went. But my marriage has been around a long time. Folks, we have to do this with our lives. Whether it's anger and hurt over horrific incidences that we can't even begin to describe, or whether it's planning for a party at the house next Thursday, we need to push our decisions through this grid. Can I say something very difficult? At the risk of making a mistake here, let me say this. There are no parents in Newtown worried about another decoration. There should be no parents in La Plata worried about that either. What matters is not the temporary, it's not the anger. It's not the need for vengeance. It's not the decoration. It's not the party. It's not the shopping list. It's not the tree. What matters It's making sure we find the time to sit in a room with all the people that God gave us and praise Him for them. What matters is that God set us free from what doesn't matter. Father, we cannot in this moment even begin to process what happened on Friday. We cannot in this moment even begin to unpack many of those things. And Lord, I don't pretend in this moment to have brought anything here today that makes all of that go away or makes it better. All we have today is You. But I want to praise You that You are more than enough. You are enough to give us freedom. You are enough to set us free. You are enough to give us, Lord, a capacity to let go, to release, to set aside the anger, the hurt, the fear, and to instead take hold of a Christ who died for us on a cross, who paid the price for our sins, who set us free, and who will lead us forward. Lord, as we go forward with whatever our plans are for today, for the rest of this week, for this holiday, for our time off work, for our time together as a family, let us, through the guidance of Your Holy Spirit, ask the right questions. And forgive us, Lord. Forgive us for focusing on what does not matter. Forgive us for focusing on things that just don't matter. Make us better, Lord, at deciding what matters in our lives. Show us what really matters and let us focus on that. Forgive us, Lord, for counting what does not count. Teach us instead to count the right things. Teach us instead to focus on the right things. Help us, Lord. Help us to see and focus on what matters, what counts, what's eternal. Help us, Lord, to focus on what lasts. And Lord, we pray. We pray for parents, husbands, family members, brothers and sisters, in a town called Newtown. We pray for Your grace on their lives. We pray for Your peace in their hearts. We pray for Your strength in these days. We pray for a peace from You that surpasses anything any of us could understand or explain. And Lord, would You apply some of that grace to us as well? Set us free from anger. Set us free from fear. Give us hope. Give us hope. Give us hope.